The Old Testament reading for the third Sunday after the Epiphany is from Isaiah chapter 9. There will be no gloom for her who was in anguish. In the former time, he brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he has made glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I appeal to you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling among you, my brothers. What I mean is that each one of you says, I believe in Paul, or I follow Apollos, or I follow Cephas, or I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one may say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the house of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, and not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. For the word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We stand for the singing of the Alleluia and the Gospel reading. Followed him. And going on from there, he saw two other brothers. in the boat with Zebedee their father, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. And he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction among the people. So his fame spread throughout all Syria, and they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, those oppressed by demons, epileptics, and paralytics, and he healed them. And great crowds followed him from Galilee and the Decapolis, and from Jerusalem and Judea, and from beyond the Jordan. This is the gospel of the Lord. Confess our Christian faith this morning in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten and not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made. Whom for us then, and for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and is at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen.
From the Catechism this morning, we continue looking at the Lord's Prayer. This morning, the second petition, Thy Kingdom Come. What does this mean?
The kingdom of God certainly comes by itself without our prayer. But we pray in this petition that it may come to us also.
How does God's kingdom come?
God's kingdom comes when our Heavenly Father gives us His Holy Spirit, so that by His grace we believe in His Holy Word and lead godly lives clear of time and error in eternity.
friends in Christ Jesus our Lord. This is the season of Epiphany, a word that literally means to shine upon. The season of the church year, in between the celebration of his birth at Christmas and preparation for his death in Lent, is especially about how Jesus makes himself known for grace and salvation. And here is your hope. The Lord will make himself known. He visits with salvation in such far-ranging places such as Zebulun, Naphtali, Racine, and wherever else you may be. The word of the Lord from St. Matthew chapter 4. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. This word of the Lord, first spoken by the prophet Isaiah about the tribes of Zebulun and Naphtali. There they were up in the northern tip of Israel, and for centuries that had been a blessed place to be. Although they were a long way from the temple in Jerusalem, they had some of the most beautiful, fertile land in the nation. But by the time Isaiah spoke, this was not a good place to be. Time and time again, foreign kings had invaded Israel from the north, making Zebulun and Naphtali their first victims. In the past too, the kingdom of Israel had split, so these northerners were cut off from the temple, the place of God's presence. But in Isaiah's time, the end was near. The Assyrian Empire was growing, expanding, and the northern kingdom was a sitting duck. It was only a matter of time until the bloodthirsty Assyrians came to Israel. And a look at the map showed how they would gain entry. Naphtali and Zebulun were living in the shadow of death because the Assyrians were not known for mercy toward others. So it happened that the northern kingdom fell, and the 10 tribes, including the people of Zebulun and Naphtali, were taken into captivity, never to be heard from again. In the course of history, boundaries would shift and others would populate the area. By the time of Jesus, it was the northern area of Galilee, and because of its diverse population, it was well described as Galilee of the Gentiles. The once fertile land was now mostly desert, and the people had again suffered at the hands of foreign armies, for once again, looking at a map, it's not difficult to figure how the Romans entered Galilee and Judea. The shadow of death seemed to darken Zebulun and Naphtali quite a bit. Then again, death seeks always to overshadow us all. It is here that the light shines in our gospel lesson today. When John the Baptist was imprisoned, Jesus withdrew to Galilee, Caesarea, and to the area of Naphtali. He voice. The Lord of life was with them. He would find his people wherever they were to be found. Now, as he went about his saving work, let's see how he proceeded. For one thing, he was establishing his credentials. He was proving that he was the Savior predicted by the Old Testament Isaiah, when Isaiah said he would heal. So he healed all sorts of diseases. Isaiah said he would do so for Zebulun and Naphtali. So there he was. But beyond the miracles to verify who he was, look at how this king spread his kingdom. He preached. He went from place to place and spoke. He taught in the synagogues, walking from town to town. Now he was also making plans to expand his efforts. In our gospel lesson, he called four men to be his disciples, and he boosted the number to 12. He'd teach and train them for a while, and he'd send them out to do the same thing. Speak his word to other people. Those disciples would perform a few miracles on his authority, though the signs and wonders would die down after a while. But even when the signs and wonders were gone, his followers would still speak his word. People would hear about him, and they'd share the news with one another. By the faith given in the word, they would seek out Jesus where he is found, where he is at hand. That's how the king went about spreading his kingdom of light and life in the New Testament. Now you may well be thinking, of course that's how he did it. This was the first century AD. It wasn't a high-tech society, no radio or cell towers, cable or satellite dishes. The quickest that news could travel was the speed of the fastest horse. But I would point out that this king was greater than the times in which he walked the earth. This was, after all, the creator of all things, and although he had become flesh and fully human, he remained fully God. If he chose, he could thunder a message from the gospel from the heavens so that everyone would hear it at once. He could write it in the sky or place the message immediately on every heart if he wanted to do it that way, but he didn't. Instead, he chose the seemingly impractical way of walking from town to town, speaking in the synagogues to those who would hear. From a human standpoint, it seems like he could better use his talents and time. Yet in his infinite wisdom, this is how the Savior went about bringing light where there was only the shadow of death. A few years later, Titus would bring more Roman armies through, and Zebulun and Naphtali would suffer once again. But before then, Jesus would win salvation for the world by his death on the cross. Ironic, isn't it? For proclaiming that all who believe will have life in for the sins of the world, and he made sure that he did not miss a single one who would believe. He made sure his word was heard, and that same word that created the heavens and the earth, created grace and eternal life in you. Now we can talk about the dangers of living in Zebulun and Naphtali all we want. Truth is, though, that no matter how dangerous it seemed back then, they experienced the same mortality rate that we do in the civilized United States of America, and indeed throughout the entire world. No matter how much we want to sanitize and shield, the truth is that we also dwell in the shadow of death. Along with all those threats that society recoils against, there are also plenty of ways that man has sought to befriend death and reject life. Abortion continues to determine that the shadow of death could reach into the womb as a matter of convenience. We live in a time of making a morning after pill available over the counter to increase the carnage. Such contempt for the helpless unborn will only lead on to contempt for the helpless outside of the womb. Our neighbor, Canada, has announced the expanding of its medical assisted suicide program to include those with mental illness, to the aged, and yes, to those who may suffer from a lack of housing, and so on. Mankind continues to glorify immorality, though it leads to disease and death itself. It's trendier to defend trees or whales than humanity today. And the list goes on and on. And these deal only with physical death. Do not forget our Lord's warning. Do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. These mid-participations of man in death are simply symptoms of the greater problem. Those who reject the Lord's grace are already dead in their trespasses and sins. They are the living dead, and it is only inevitable that those who reject God will seek to justify death as a helper, a solace, and friend. In such a world, it's easy to become discouraged. It's even easier when this gets personal. The evening news can often be enough to depress when the shadow of death darkens the lives of people halfway around the world. But sooner or later, that death casts its silhouette into your life, too. The onslaught of disease, the loss of a friend, or the near miss, each reminds us that our greatest enemy patiently stalks us. It's easy to be discouraged, even despairing. That's why, even as our society does because it's best to ignore death or make it sound like a kind companion. It's full of desperate, despairing people. Do not despair, for the word of the Lord remains. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and upon those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. Death may seem ever present, but the Lord is far more so. He has defeated this enemy and risen again, and he makes sure that his light shines upon those who sit in darkness. Do not despair, little flock. In this world where death reigns because of sin, the Lord faithfully visits his people, be they in Racine or Fallujah or a lone believer in Sweden. He brings with him forgiveness and victory over death. This victory is missed by many because, again, the Lord comes quietly and mercifully. He spread this grace and victory around Zebulun and Naphtali and Galilee by walking from town to town preaching his word. And this is how his evangelism still happens today. As people talked of Jesus and Christians told his word to others back then, so they do today. While the Lord can accomplish his will without us, he delights to use us as his instruments in the spread of his salvation. People hear the word and come to church to hear more, to be catechized, instructed in the ways of the Lord. Believers gather to hear the absolution, to be baptized, to receive the Lord's body and blood. It looks ordinary, but know this: the Lord's work will look ordinary. After all, he created this world and set it up to run normally according to his will. Therefore, because the Lord's will is the normal way of doing things, it will look normal. Rather than have bread fall from heaven each day, he ordains that seeds sprout and grow into grain that is harvested, ground, and baked. But as he uses the farmers and bakers to supply bread, it is no less the Lord's plan. Likewise, he delights to give forgiveness in his word and his sacraments, and they appear quite normal because that's how the Lord normally saves. This is no less a miracle than if the Lord started zapping individuals with salvation via lightning bolts from heaven. The Lord's way of evangelism will seem ordinary, and it may even seem inefficient as the church plods towards eternity. But of this we are comforted as well. Christ Jesus will not fail to send forth his word to save all who will believe. He will not lose one of his beloved children. And as he fulfills that promise, you and I have the privilege of being cold and dark, chilling and fearful, but in Christ it passes and it's gone. That's the message of Epiphany, and that is the purpose of evangelism. In this dying world where death is feared, touted as a friend, or used for convenience, the Lord of life makes himself known. He made himself known in human flesh to die our death and set us free. He makes himself known in his word even now to forgive your sins and give you victory over the grave. Rejoice, dear people of God, for this victory in Christ is yours with these simple words. You are forgiven for all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen. Welcome to the sick, the afflicted, and those oppressed by demons and heal them. my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, when he had given thanks. He gave it to them saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve him in the true faith unto life everlasting. Depart in his peace. Amen. Children, but always